But overall, how would you assess the National Assembly in the last one year?
It's been a disaster.
The first year of the current session of the National Assembly has exposed the country to ridicule. The business of lawmaking was abandoned completely, and it was all about how do we pad the budget to enrich ourselves, or how do we confer immunity on ourselves? Or, okay, if we cannot get immunity, why don't you summon the Attorney General of the country, or the Chairman of the Code of Conduct Tribunal, or a trial judge, so that we let them recognize that we are a special specimen of the Homo sapiens. You know, we're special people. We are not, we cannot be held to account for our actions. But happily, on every occasion, Nigerians and the media rose to the occasion and made it clear to them, you cannot operate outside the laws of the country. I do hope that the patriotic members of the National Assembly, and you can find them in both houses, are beginning to appreciate that they need to distance themselves from the embarrassment caused by their colleagues all the time. And I was very happy when some members of the House of Reps made it clear that there's no way we can confer immunity on our side. It doesn't happen anywhere in the world. There's no National Assembly in any part of the world that has conferred or has used the law to confer immunity on the members. What operates in all civilized countries, and Nigeria is one, right, is that legislators enjoy limited immunity in term, and that is captured in the under our law. I mean, in our laws. I mean, you have the Legislative Powers and Privileges Act that has conferred immunity on members of the National Assembly with respect to contributions made by them in the course of debates. I remember I handled a case about 3 years ago where a legislator in Kano, I mean, Bauchi House of Assembly, a lady, you know, Honorable Dana, was making a contribution in the House. In a society where you have male domination, she was the only member in a 31-member House of Assembly, only female member. They felt her contribution was too outlandish for them to accommodate. So the members gang up with the speaker to suspend her indefinitely. She was suspended. We went to court for her. We got judgment. They went on appeal. We got judgment. And the court of appeal made it clear to them that the essence of democracy is to allow members to debate without any fear that they may lose their seat. And there's no way you can subject a member of the National Assembly or any House of Assembly to indefinite suspension, because that was tantamount to deny our constituency any representation. So the members of the National Assembly have to be made to know that we operate under the rule of law, whereby nobody can say, I am the law, and therefore I can do what I like. Even there is a campaign for the abolition of executive immunity, because it has been abused, whereby a governor can say, I can loot the treasury of my state. You cannot question me. I enjoy immunity. No. I remember one of the recommendations of the 2014 National Conference, a unanimous resolution, is that executive immunity should not cover corruption, murder, and other criminal offenses. Because people have abused executive immunity, whose purpose initially was to prevent heads of government from distractions. But people now have taken advantage of that to say, no, I can commit any offense since I'm going to be here for the next 4 or 8 years. By the time I'm leaving office, you will have forgotten about it. Or the evidence can no longer be found. So this is why Nigerians are saying, no, even for the heads of government, we must look at the abuse of immunity by some of them. Not to talk of now extending immunity to cover legislators. And before you know it, we'll also be talking of immunity to cover judges. From there, it must cover all civil servants.
Away from the National Assembly, let's talk about the anti-graft war of the federal government. Some people say that it's losing steam, it's one-sided, and it's not far-reaching enough. What do you think?
It has to be one-sided against the looters of the treasury. It has to be. You can't go and arrest everybody in town, including victims of corruption. Initially, we were told that it was targeted at the PDP, yet no member of the PDP was arrested, ever denied their involvement in the looting, mega looting of the treasury. Secondly, the government has actually arrested more military officers than politicians. The records is there. Nobody has ever spoken for those military officers, as if they are not Nigerian. Nobody is talking of selectivity of prosecution when it comes to military officers who diverted huge funds, I think to the tune of $15 billion, to acquire arms and ammunition for counter-insurgency operations. Nobody is complaining. But on behalf of a handful of politicians, who diverted money meant for development of the country. And that is what people are talking of, selective trial.
But don't you think it's one-sided because there are allegations against certain people in government who are also said to be corrupt?
I have spoken out against just a couple. And I have warned the government to beware of the enemies within. Because if care is not taken, if the government does not move speedily to deal with any member of the government who is indicted, the government will on its own discredit the anti-corruption war. So I'm aware that petitions have just been filed by some concerned human rights organizations. And if the government does not move, we file actions before the Federal High Court with a view to obtaining an order of mandamus to compel the government to move against those two people that have been indicted.
Let's end with something for the lawyers. You were one of the earliest advocates of this NBA e-voting. Would you say so far that you're impressed with the way the process has been introduced and implemented?
Genuine fears have been expressed with respect to attempts or alleged attempts to manipulate the process. And I've personally called on the president of the NBA, Mr. Augustin Alegre-SN, who has assured me that he's going to ensure that the process is transparent. We started the campaign for universal suffrage in the bar. And when we were told that it would be difficult to manage, we suggested the idea of e-voting. But I can assure you, we're not going to allow e-voting to become irrigating in the interest of the bar and the society.